Sorry, OBS disconnected. You probably didn't miss much. This to allow what she had just said to sink into the minds of those in the audience. Yep. Yep. She was silent for a few seconds. The soft starlight flowed down upon her pale cheeks as if by the design of time itself.
星座のご案内の次は、 いよいよ記念投影となります。 題しまして、 宇宙に羽ばたく。
And when all of the stars disappeared, it felt as if she had just let out a shriek to which she could give no voice. What happened? Even as I bolted out of my seat, I stopped mid-motion. The darkness surrounding me was so profound that it was as if the other chairs, the dome, and even all the space around me had vanished. Suddenly, a light arose from the front. She was enveloped in a gentle yellow aura, not unlike that from a candle.
お客様、どうぞ落ち着いてください。
She said to me as I ran up to her.
私の制服には光繊維が織り込まれています。照明が戻るまでしばらく私のそばでお待ちください。
What happened? The light bulb burn out?
イエナさんが反応しません。すべての投影装置および稼働軸が動きません。私単体では対処できない重大な事態です。とても困りました。
Damn it! From my way to the top of the projector pedestal, I grew worried that something serious was amiss. The three green emergency lights that had continued shining with low luminosity even during the projection had completely gone out. Then I understood. This was not a breakdown in the projector, nor was it something that was particularly easy to solve. Where's the fuse board?
はい、こちらです。She
pulled the interface cable out of its socket near her ear. I followed her as she walked without fear or hesitation in the darkness. The problem was simple. It was so simple that it verged on idiotic, that it was difficult for me to truly accept that it happened in the first place. The weak stream of electrical power from the sarcophagic city that somehow miraculously supplied this place for over 30 years had died out during the one time when it was actually needed. Or perhaps the operation of the projector itself was the trigger of the outage. But no matter what the cause was, I had no way of restoring the power.
お客様?
As I had carried on my useless struggle with the fuse board, she had fallen mysteriously silent, but at last she opened her mouth again.
イエナさんを修理するにはどのような工具が必要でしょうか? 恒星電球を交換すればいいのでしょうか? お客様がいらっしゃるのに投影を中断するなどあってはならない事態です。 記念投影をご覧になるのはお客様が最初なんです。当館のスタッフ一同が心を込めて制作した自信作なんです。
I'm guessing she's going to have to give all the power left in her body to it.
ですから...
She stared at me beseechingly with her eyes wide open. There's no malfunction. The power has been cut off, is all.
申し訳ありませんが、意味がよくわかりませんでした。
Electricity has been cut off. It's an electrical outage. Do you understand?
はい、停電ですね。しばらくすれば非常用電源に切り替わります。
This place has been supplied all along by that emergency power of which you speak. Now that it's been cut off, we are out of options.
それでは、いつ頃元に戻るでしょう?
It will never return. It is not a problem with just this building, either.
それでは、どのようにすれば投影を再開できるでしょう?
I could not say anything.
私にお手伝いできることがあれば、何なりとお申し付けください。
She again sank into silence, eagerly awaiting my words. She was like a mother who had already knew the condition of her child's disease by reading the doctor's facial expression. I could clearly feel every single second passing me by. She rose from her sitting position and turned towards me.
お客様、それでは特別投影はもう…
Listen closely to what I have to say. I stopped her before she said what she was going to say.
はい.
Continue the projection. Your voice will be enough.
Oh.
As she shook her head slowly, the halo of delicate phosphorescence surrounded her moved like a veil.
申し訳ありませんが、意味がよくわかりませんでした。
Doesn't matter whether the projector activates or not. What I want to hear is your explanation's commentary. Can you do that?
はい、できます。ですが、私の解説だけでは投影になりません。
It's okay. It's about the stars, and I'll be able to see everything. Just from you speaking, I'll know all of what it is that you want to show me. All of this coming from my mouth was nonsense. Even I didn't understand why I was saying these things. She peered at my face with great curiosity and somehow even greater yearning. I felt as if she was seeing right through me. And slowly, she began to speak. It was a tone of voice that I had never heard up until now from her, something close to shocked laughter. Her smile alone seemed to flood the endless darkness with her gentle light.
ずっと昔のことです。冷たくて暗い洞穴の中で、人の祖先たちは身を寄せ合って暮らしていました。世界は氷に覆われていて、鋭い牙のある獣がそこら中にうろうろしています。毎日生きていくだけの食べ物を手に入れるだけで精一杯でした。ある凍てつく夜、一人の若者が目を覚ましました。きっとあまり寒くてお腹もペコペコで、 眠れなかったのでしょう。眠い目をこすりながら、彼は洞穴の入り口から、そーっと外を覗いてみました。冴え渡った夜空いっぱいに、たくさんの星がキラキラと輝いていました。The
river of mankind spreading its wings toward the cosmos. That was the title of the special projection. The concept seems simple enough. To have this robot girl narrate the story of how mankind, which had always been always longing to reach out to the stars, was now on the verge of attaining its goal. A darkness as thick and impenetrable as wet ash settled once again around me. I could not even make out the outline of the projector. I closed my eyes and concentrated with all my heart on imagining the things of which she spoke. This way, she would be in control of not just that piece of machinery known as Miss Gina, but of all the equipment capable of projecting an image in the room. The slide projector installed on the pedestal would begin to project, one side at a time, genealogy of mankind as it strove to reach past the sky. Of the man who had fashioned wings out of birds' feathers and affixed those wings to their arms, and the tragic result. Of the floating paper balloons that amused the king, and of the laboratory for the inventor that had become a gilded cage for its prisoner. Of the man who silently experimented over and over again with crude gliders that made of bamboo and cane. Of the men who invented the first aircraft, of its first flight in the billowing dunes, witnessed by so few. Of the fanciful Victorian engineers who built rockets in an attempt to head to the moon, and of wars that swallowed up the entire world in their mad conflagrations. Of the first artificial satellite, of the first radio signal from space, of the dog Laika, who would never come home to Earth. Of the pilots who challenged the stratosphere, of the first manned space flights, of the first space walk. And of mankind's first footprints on the moon.
争いの時代は終わりました。世界中の人々が手を取り合って宇宙を目指す時が来たのです。Her
voice resounded clearly through time and space, bringing me all the way from the distant past all the way up to the present.
高みへ、遥かな高みへ。
Of an international satellite communications network, a space shuttle system, an international space station, and have plans to return to the surface of the moon. Of the many unavoidable tragedies that occurred as mankind soared higher and higher. And of the international manned mission to Mars. A laser pointer would now be directing me at a red star shining in the southern sky, and I imagined a slow, close-up flyby of the surface of that red planet, Mars.
これが火星です。直径6794km、公転周期685日、平均気温マイナス55度。
Damn it! Earth herself is quite thin, and its composed mainly of carbon dioxide. この赤い星の表面に運河らしき痕跡が発見されると、人類はそこから隣人の姿や物語を思い描きました。
それは高度に発達した科学を持つ異形の侵略者であり、美しいお姫様との英雄譚であり、調和の今では火星は、かつて生命が存在した痕跡だけを持つ死の星であることが分かっています。ですが、火星の運河をもとに綴られたたくさんの物語は、今も色褪せることなく、人々を引きつけてやみません。
At that point, she paused for a second.
人類初の有人火星探査が成功したその年に、当プラネタリウムは開館しました。それ以来、本当にたくさんの方々が、ここで投影をご覧になりました。この火星の姿は、まさに宇宙開発の成果とその象徴です。そして同時に、戦いの神、マルスの象徴でもあります。
The image of Mars would now slowly fade, and be replaced by a complex sphere of blue, green, and white, shining as brilliantly as glass.
ご覧ください。太陽系第三惑星。これが私たちの地球です。地球は遥かな昔から人類のゆりかごであり、これからも人類のふるさとであり続けるでしょう。ロボットである私も地球で生まれました。地球にまつわるさまざまな数値を私は皆様に正確に説明することができます。ですが、この美しさを正確に説明するためには、ソフトウェアの一層の熟成が必要なようです。
She smiled almost as if shy about her words, then she again fell silent for a little while.
より良い心に近づくことは、ロボットの特権ではありません。人口問題、エネルギー問題、食料問題、水源問題、海面上昇、異常気象、大気汚染、そして宇宙領土問題。今、世界にはさまざまないさかいや争い事があります。ですが、私は信じています。人はすべての問題を必ず解決し、いつの日かきっと星の世界を駆け巡ることでしょう。
She was now a priestess telling of oracular visions. With graceful actions, she extended her arms wide in the darkness. The starry sky now belongs to you. That was the message she was conveying with childlike innocence to every single person born on this planet.
今宵は特別に、とっておきの秘密を打ち明けましょう。プラネタリウムはタイムマシンでもあるんです。遠い過去から遥かな未来まで、自由自在に時間を操ることができるんです。
This following portion of the presentation will now be turned over to Miss Gina. Nature once again come to life, and the steel casing will once again tremble with joy. The motor would speak one last time, beginning to emit its slow signature aria. And then, like a gentle dinosaur green snake, the fixed star balls would begin to draw a complex slow key. Within a microcosm bereft of color, new stars would begin to radiate with brilliance.
ご覧ください。今からちょうど1000年後の夜、この場所から見える星空です。ロボットの星野夢美と投影機のイエナさんが一生懸命に紡いだささやかな未来の星空です。
I don't know where her voice is coming from anymore. The customers in the sold-out auditorium would.Alternately be hushed in amazement or clamoring in excitement, staring up at the starry sky with intoxication. Past the confines of this dome lay a vast ocean of light. Like an hourglass of the gods concealed under a curtain of gold, the Light radiated everywhere, without beginning or end. She slowly closed her eyes and clasped her hands as if in prayer.
どうか皆さん、覚えていてください。 星の世界が手の届かない憧れではなく、ありふれた暮らしの場になっても、どうかここで見た星空を忘れないでください。あなたが暗闇に迷い、本当の星空が見えなくなってしまった時、それが小さな私の夢です。それでは。
The projection would be on its home stretch now. The stars would grow ever more radiant, as if they were being polished by her voice. Having finished its duties, the projector would be returning to its home position. And likewise, the diurnal axis would be revolving back to its original resting spot, like a boat returning to safe harbor.
オリオン座、ヨシャ座、オウシ座、私たちの頭上で夜ごと繰り広げられる雄大な季節の移ろいです。
And now a faint light would be starting to suffuse the sky. As dull crimson light would begin to fill the eastern sky, the radiance of stars begun to weaken. The barely visible stars of the western sky would now dim, as if they were receding into the distance, and then they would vanish entirely.
やがて長かった夜は終わり、世界に朝が訪れます。太陽が上がってきました。小鳥のさえずりや、 風のさざめきが聞こえます。まどろんでいたビルや並木たちも、新しい日差しに眠い目をこすっています。もうすぐ街が動き出します。今日も変わらない一日が始まります。皆様、おはようございます。それでは、これで記念投影を終了します。 この回の解説は、私、星野夢美でお送りしました。ご清聴ありがとうございました。当館スタッフ一同、またのお越しを心よりお待ちしております。
Even though the direction was over, I didn't open my eyes. I could still vividly see all those trails of stardust like so many afterimages with my eyes closed. Right now, I was looking to open my eyes and return to the pitch black darkness.
お客様、本日の投影は終了しました。
I could hear precise, regular footsteps making their way to me.
お客様。お客様。
I could hear the roaring of micro motors, which told me that she was gently cocking her head in doubt once again. I thought I opened my eyes before she inevitably asked me, "Are you feeling ill?" But just then, her voice shrank down to a whisper.
"投影が終了したら、すべてのお客様を速やかに出口にご案内するのが原則なんですが、諸事情を勘案しますと、お客様にはこのまま朝までお休みいただくのが最善と考えます。"
A chair beside me squeaked, and I could feel that she was sitting down. I continued to pretend to be asleep.
お客様の中には、投影中に眠ってしまう方もたくさんいます。途中で泣き出してしまう子供のお客様もいます。そんな時には、私が非常口から外にご案内して、投影…
As she reminisced about old times, she lapsed into silence for a second.
お客様、特別投影はいかがだったでしょう。 当館のスタッフ一同が心を込めて制作した自信作です。以前に館長さんは、星空の下で眠ることが人間には一番の贅沢なんだと教えてくれました。ですからきっと、 客様は満足してくれたのだと思います。私はとても嬉しいです。お客様は今どんな夢を見ているのでしょう。私はロボットなので夢は見ないのですが、でもきっとお客様は楽しい夢を見ているのだと思います。
She didn't suck my side without end, as if she were telling a child a bedtime story. And I swore that I would remember about the olden days, before the rain began to fall upon this world. I was a little boy then. The colony in which I lived was overcrowded, so there was a chronic shortage of drinking water, medicine, and food. Even so, the number of refugees that came every day was greater than the number of those who died. As the toxic contamination of the world was at that point, concentrated in the southern hemisphere, during times when there was still no smog, we were even allowed to go outside without any protective suits. I remember coming out of the airlock, held in someone's arms. I think it was on a late midwinter night. It was pitch black outside, and the air was freezing cold. The person who was holding me did not move an inch and just stood absolutely still in the darkness. The person merely looked skyward, forever staring into a gap in the thick, overlapping clouds. I had forgotten the sensation of that person touching my cheek. Lost to frozen time. That person, surely, was my mother. There were other adults in the vicinity, but none of them stirred an inch, looking up at the empty sky as if they had been petrified. Were there stars in that sky? I swore that I would remember. Next day, the rain continued to fall. It was as if it had been that way since the beginning of the world.
Planetarium はいかがでしょう。どんな時も決して消えることのない美しい無休のきらめき、満天の星々が皆様をお待ちしています。
She continued to address the rain with her lucid voice as if nothing had changed.
こんにちは、お客様。ご気分はいかがでしょう。
She noticed me, she gave me the same salutation that she always did. Not particularly good, but not bad either.
そうですか。もしもまだご体調が優れないようでし。
I'm fine.
はい、それは良かったです。お客様はこれからお帰りですか？
Yeah.
投影が不完全で本当に申し訳ありませんでした。心よりお詫び申し上げます。
Well, I started for no particular good reason. The rejection wasn't bad.
お褒めいただき、本当に嬉しいです。それに、お客様には、いろいろと助けていただきました。本当にありがとうございました。
My grenade launcher, my waterproof cloak, and my backpack all felt several times heavier than usual. Because the humidity in the projection room had risen due to the shutdown of the air conditioners, I could again feel the dull ache from several old wounds.I did not even get a good night's sleep that night. I was all out of food. I could feel that I would soon run out of strength. None of these things were the cause of my current reflective mood. Say.
はい、何でしょう?
Just what do you plan on doing from now on? I choked down the words I had been on the verge of saying. It was a completely senseless question. Should we be waiting without question or complaint on this rooftop for more customers to come?For the staff members to return, and for the electricity projector to be restored. When her batteries are exhausted, she would connect her charging socket to his cable and simply close her eyes. And then, she would never move again. That was the certain future that would visit itself upon her body in a matter of a few dozen hours at the most.
お客様?
Are you waiting for customers today too?
いえ、今日は水曜日ですので、当デパートは
全館休業となっています。Who closes on a Wednesday?So you have the day off?
はい、お休みです。
And how do you usually spend your days off?
はい、私には休暇は必要ありませんので、細々とした用事をこなしています。
Is that so?
前年の休業日には花束を作り直していました。8年ほど前に作ったものが壊れてしまいましたので。
Are you talking about that bouquet you gave me?
はい、次は本物の綺麗な花束を用意してお待ちしています。
I see. That dubious bouquet of artificial flowers had been cleared away from my sight some time ago without am I even noticing? Which customer did you say I was again?
Hi. お客様は ちょうど 249万7290番目のお客様です。
Since you gave me that bouquet, then I guess I'd better be the 2,500,000th customer as well.
はい、心よりお待ちしています。
The least I could do for her was to engage her one last time in the idle talk that she seemed to love so much. When I was in the middle of repairing the projector, I certainly thought that this might not be too bad a place to die. But the feeling, which wasn't far from intoxication, was now vanishing like a fad from a bygone era. In its place was something that could be called a longing for others. I wanted to head toward the places where people still set foot and live their lives on this little planet, even if I should perish along the way. Yes, there's part of me that felt that way. Even if it amounted to nothing more than a mere instinct that, from the very beginning, had been embedded in every single one of those living things known as human beings, even so. I'm heading off now. If you would, send a prayer to the God of Robots for me, then I might survive the trip back. At that moment, she turned strangely serious. The words, which had started off so cheerfully, trailed off into hesitance.
お客様、失礼ですが、お聞きしてよろしいでしょうか?
What is it?
お帰りの道中に危険がございますか?
If I said no, then I'd probably be lying. I answered, thus lengthening the aisle chatter that I'd grown so used to.
お帰りの際は電車にお乗りになりますか?
The subways aren't running. There's an electrical outage right now, remember?
はい、その通りでした。 ただいま行動データベースに考慮事項として追加しました。
She replied thus, even though she knew that there was an electrical outage, that did not mean that she could necessarily string together the consequences of that situation.
それでは、バスかタクシーか、お車でお帰りですか?
A car, probably. On the way in, during my battle with three other junkers at the rift in the commentary wall, the engine of my motorcycle had been shot to pieces. The Land Rover that my three colleagues had come in was undamaged, but its two passengers were a completely different matter, fitting end to a forced dealing. If I could successfully escape the city, then I could take that car and drive it to a nearby settlement. But if that car were out of gas, I was destined to die a dog's death. Not quite. Approximately, although I don't exactly know. I asked such a question was obviously very different from the idle talk that she was so fond of. Why asking these things of me?
ただいまサポートセンターと更新中です。少々お待ちください。
She want to walk with me? Said with a dead serious voice, not answering my question. I cannot help but feel that there was something in that voice that I had never heard before. Hey.
わかりました。
She was just about to prod her for a second time when she returned to her usual smile.
お客様のお車まで。
Oh, we'll squirt you to your car, Mr.
Customer.
Yeah. What did you say?
はい。お客様のお車まで私がご同行しますと申しました。
How was I supposed to respond to this? As I fretted over how to reply, she merely continued to smile.
お年寄りやご病気の方をエスコートするのは私たちロボットの役目です。 どうぞお気になさらないでください。
Is who are you calling weak and elderly?
Hi.
She cocked her head slightly.
申し訳ありません。ただいま大変失礼な発言をしてしまいました。本当に申し訳ありません。
Once again, that incessant flood of words. There had been times when I had seen this kind of slapstick comedy on old-fashioned film reels. When I first entered this planetarium, I came face to face with a genuine article. Are you all in there?
いいえ、少しだけ壊れています。
That is not what I'm talking about.
当外区が現在停電中でしたら、お客様を一人では道中に危険があると考えます。本日は休業日ですので、当デパートのお客様案内はお休みとなっております。現在、当館で稼働するロボットは私しかおりませんので、お客様を安全にお送りするのは私の義務だと考えます。
She only used the phrase, I believe, during times when she was absolutely certain that her notions were correct. In other words, I would literally not be able to move her otherwise, not even with a lever. Are you okay with leaving your post? はい。
現在サポートセンターに職務規定特例第12条第4項に基づく行動指示要求を発信していますが、受講されませんので、以降は私が独自の判断により行動することになります。
Securely asserted.
これも何かの縁ということで、同行してよろしいでしょうか?
I sighed again. It seemed that I had underestimated her yet again. Or it may well have been that I had forever disrupted a garden that heretofore been maintained an exquisite balance.
同行してよろしいでしょうか?
Of course, I shouldn't have let her accompany me. I should have freed myself from the grasp of this broken robot and returned to the solitary life of a junker. However, her artificial optic resin eyes were sharply focused and gazing at me intently. My mind had been an empty desert, a clattering graveyard of hollow sounds. Indeed, that had been the world in which I had walked up until now. But now, grains of stars were shining like a stain undying on an unperishably dark heart of hearts that had long been without a single decent thought. Damn it. Seized by an impulse that I myself could not fathom, I armed my grenade launcher. How much longer will your batteries last?
はい、現状の業務モードでしたら、あと4日活動できます。
How fast can you walk?
最大歩行速度は平坦路で時速 8km となっています。
How do you plan on returning?
はい、現在、測地衛星による位置情報が取得できませんが、現在位置から半径 3km 以内でしたら、どの場所からでも単独で帰着が可能です。
Will you be okay in the rain?
はい、私の筐体は第2種業務防水仕様。
You told me this earlier, so you're saying that the rain has never caused you to stop moving or anything like that?
はい、雨天下での行動に問題はありません。
Well, she spoke with such confidence, the rain had that fell now was completely different from the rain that fell 30 years ago. This whole class 2 waterproofing thing was dubious as well.
同行してよろしいでしょうか?
Finally, I answered her. Do as you wish.
ありがとうございます。
She bowed deeply to me.
それでは、参りましょう。
Saying this, she produced something from the inside of the reception desk.
どうぞ。
Aww. The thing that she was presenting to me with a huge smile on her face was that self-styled bouquet again. Just when I thought I had seen less of it, there it was again. What the hell is this?
お客様の花束です。大切にお預かりしていましたので。
So she would not be satisfied unless I took a souvenir with me after all. Was that it? I recall asking you to safekeep it for me.
はい。投影室内にお落としになられたようでしたので、こちらで保管しておきました。
I didn't forget it. I threw it away.
はい。そうなんですか。
She replied thus, but her facial expression obviously told me that she understood nothing.
どうぞご安心ください。投影中にお荷物をお預かりするのは無料サービスとなっておりますので。
And then sighed again. Not her kindness, but the way that I was caving in. Since you have it, do whatever you want with it. I don't want it right now.
わかりました。お客様のお車まで、私が責任を持ってお持ちしますので。
She responded thus to what I said. I couldn't help but feel that her ability to interpret my words to her utmost favor was quite incredible.
それから、今日の天気ですと傘が必要ですね。ただいま用意します。
She briefly laid the bouquet down and turned to go back to the counter. I grabbed her and stopped her. If I allowed her to have her way any longer, I would probably end up carrying everything and the kitchen sink. Forget about the umbrella. I'll lend you a coat. I obviously opened it and took out a spare waterproof cloak.
いえ、そのようなわけには。
If you're going to come with me, at least listen to what I have to say. Come on, put it on by yourself. I thrust the dirty cloak at her.
はい、それではお言葉に甘えまして。
She bowed low as if she were receiving a medal from me. Streets were empty. Shutters encrusted with rust and bicycles standing where they had been abandoned 30 years ago, being deluged by the rain. I flipped off the safety of my grenade launcher and I slowly surveyed my surroundings. There was no sign of warmongers, nor were there any signs of pedestrians with their umbrellas. Nothing at all had changed since I had first arrived in the sarcophagus city. I was very strongly struck by the incongruous feeling that I was the only living being in this entire place now. It was the first time that I had felt such a thing.
誰もいませんね。
She said, as if she were musing about the exact same thing that I was. That's because of the rain. Let's go. Watched out into the street from the east. Wearing the hood of my cloak low over my eyes. As I heard the sound of the rain hitting the road, the feeling of incongruity disappeared. At that moment, she seemed to hesitate over something. I crossed the main street without slowing down and then concealed myself near the opposite sidewalk. Hurry up! Finally, she began to cross as well. She walked with a relaxed gait, as if she were going shopping in the neighborhood. Faster!
はい、わかりました.
She looked over to me and smiled. Just then, a sheet of spray sprouted up. She lost her balance and sprawled over in the middle of the road. Bracing herself with both hands, she rose in the most smooth and refined manner. After that, she picked up the bouquet from the mud, then continued to cross the road as if nothing had happened.
お待たせしました.
Thank you for waiting. Now, why did I say that? I'm only going to ask once more. Ask once. Are you right?
はい、ただいま姿勢制御がやや不安定になっているようです。ですが、少々の転倒なら自力で回復が可能な設計ですので。
Make sure you don't fall in the first place, then.
はい、申し訳ありません。
Slightly bowed her head with complete calm.
今の転倒で花束が少し壊れてしまいました。申し訳ありません。
I don't care.
ありがとうございます。 それはそれとして、 お客様は失礼ですが。
If you're going to insist on chattering, at least whisper.
はい、わかりました。
Your voice obediently shrank down to a whisper.
それで失礼ですが、 信号機を無視した道路横断は大変危険ですので。
Let go. There's an electrical outage right now. More importantly, can't you walk any faster?
はい、先ほどの歩行が 最大速度となります。
8 kilometers per hour, huh?
はい、時速8キロです。
She confirmed, puffing out her chest proudly. Aww.
ところで、今日は本当に人通りが少ないですね。
It's always like this.
やはり、どこも不景気なんですね。
She said earnestly, looking at the depressed remains of buildings that seemed to lend credence to her words.
前回外出した折には、 たくさんの方々でにぎわっていたのですが。
I started putting together a plan of action. It was a little over 3 kilometers from here to the rift in the quarantine wall. At least as the bird flew. If she's going to continue to fall over in the middle of the road and scold me over traffic laws that had been ceased to be years ago, we could probably just barely reach the rift in an hour. However, the patrolling sounds of heavy hunter... This is dangerous... Wait. The patrolling squads of heavy... Sounds... of heavy hunter-killer mechs made it dangerous to utilize the major roads. So it'd be probably better to take a detour east and head toward the rift using the side paths. Even so, that was going to take several hours. She was the big problem here. If any of the autonomous gunmen used to spot this ditz of a companion robot, she would not be able to produce a corresponding IFS signal and would thus be targeted as an enemy mech. While their scanners would not detect the signature of a living organism coming from her, there was no mistake that they would pick up on her movements. Alright, listen up.
Hi.
If you're going to continue following me, then do not open your mouth. And if you happen to get separated from me, then don't worry and head straight home. Which command is that a response to?
はい、後者です。 諸事情を勘案しますと、 お客様を無事にお送りすることが私の使命だと考えます。
Your mission, huh? I had heard those words being spoken so many times before in the past, but I had never once met a person who had truly believed in them.
それに、実を申しますと、 私は外出するのが好きなんです。以前はよく街角に立って通行人の方々に投影のお知らせをしたものです。プラネタリウムはいかがでしょう?
Look, I told you not to speak if at all possible.
はい、申し訳ありません。
She had the next 10 seconds to pass in silence, that she were punishing herself for her trespasses. I was confronted with a problem that had no solution. Just what do you think taking her with me like this? It was true that I could not for even a second, think that it was permissible to just leave her in that planetarium that had now lost all its faculties. What other choices did I have? Hers was an existence that should have ceased to be 30 years ago. Just why did I care so much about this broken robot? Damn it.
お客様?
I'm fine. Don't worry about it.
はい.
Right, there was no time to be thinking about this kind of problem right now. I could not do anything about whether she was going to continue to exist or not with my hands alone. When emergency struck, it would just be better to desert her. She wouldn't be able to catch up to me either. I didn't care what would become of her after that. Let's go.
Hi.
once again stepped out into the rain. Space of 1 hour, I felt as if I had already done a decade's worth of penance. The air had grown chilly, and the rain was continuing to fall as it always had. Although the sidewalks were also immersed, they were not so bad as to be unwalkable yet. It did not seem as if there were any combat units in the area either. If I made skillful use of the alleyways, the various road blockades would not be much of a problem too. Yet I still found myself in the heart of the sarcophagus city. She's happily twisting in her entire body. She looked around. Sure enough, there was a fallen billboard on the side of the road that read, "Delicious handmade cream puffs here." But the line of which she spoke was nowhere to be seen. Within the span of these 30 years, a baker's skill must have fallen considerably. I've never eaten them before, so whether I like them or not is irrelevant. There's no line, but there's no merchandise either. So this, she looked with wonder at the refrigerated case that not only had a price tag sticking on it. As if nothing unfortunate had happened at all. Look, cut out the guided tour and just concentrate on walking faster. I'm in a hurry. Just as she said that, one of her feet got snagged on the junction between two tiles. Just like that, she lost balance and tumbled to the ground with a crash. The bouquet flew from her hands and parts of the flowers scattered about. She did not cry out, nor did she clutch any parts of her body in pain. It's almost like a silent comedy. She got up in a single smooth moment and then picked up the fallen bouquet with a conscientious air. I don't care. Look, I get it. So no more of these performances. Something in the past couple of hours had happened. She stepped up to a large fluorescent billboard.
こちらのビルの5階には当デパート提携のビアホールがございます。新鮮な魚介料理とともに様々な地ビールをお楽しみになれます。今でしたらお得な飲食割引券が印刷できます。よろしければお寄りになってはいかがでしょう。
Are you coming with me in order to nurse me along, or are you coming with me in order to give me discount coupons? Just one of the two, is it? As she looked up at me in worry. That is not what I meant. Now please, quit it with your care and just walk more quickly. She answers her with her usual smile.
There
has nothing to do with them. If you need them, then you use them. Right, just be grateful and take them back. It was telling me that there was no way I could correct her tendency to chatter, not anytime soon. At least there was the fact that there was little chance that our sounds could be detected from any long distance, thanks to the constant pounding of the rain. But the burning problem was... She suddenly stopped as if she had read my mind. Since unlike a human being, her movements were never telegraphed, it was disconcerting no matter how many times I had watched her. Need another break? She said apologetically she should stop still. Seeing that her movement was made possible by a network of old-style micromotors and conductive fiber meshes. The flaw in that particular design was the fact that the entire apparatus tended to overheat quite rapidly when participating in anything more than light labor. On top of that, her cooling system was not in the best shape either. In terms of her manufacture date, she was much older than I was, although there were probably several chronic diseases lying in wait for me fairly soon as well. I understand. Now having any other choice, I headed over to the innermost parts of the eaves and sat down. She walked next to me, bent her knees, and gently sat down as well. She quietly placed the bouquet on the ground next to her. This was our fourth break already. How far have we walked now?
Hi. 花火師デパートの表口から計測しまして1122メートルです。
I opened the cover to my watch and took stock of the time. So our average speed is 1 km per hour.
はい、平均時速およそ1キロです。
And what is your top speed again?
時速8キロです。
I see. How impressive. I did not feel as if I could calm down unless I could somehow summon the fool who had drawn up her specification sheet and fire a few rounds into him. It is. I don't.
そうですか。実を申しますと、私は雨が大好きなんです。
Does he get more customers coming to the planetarium?
はい、その通りなんです。
I thought as much.
はい、以前に館長さんは、雨が降っていると星が特別貴重なものに感じられるんだよと教えてくれました。
I see.
そうそう、以前にこんなことがありました。あるお客様からプラネタリウムの中では傘がいりますかと問い合わせをいただいたんです。
I raised my waterproof cloak a little bit and unfastened the canteen from my belt. While I drank that foul-smelling water, she stopped talking and merely stared over at me.
お客様？
What?
差し支えなければ、お客様の病状について、私も情報。
She said with a dead serious face, so it seemed that there was no longer any way to dissuade her from thinking that I was sick. My illness? My illness, huh? I stopped right up the canteen and gazed up at the sky. I thought about how bad it would be to allow the downpouring drops of rain to strike exposed skin. It's a very common condition, nothing really worth worrying about.
はい、申し訳ありませんでした。
She said easily. It seemed that she had decided that it would be wiser to press no further. It struck me as funny that even someone whose talkativeness could wear out a saint would know that there were certain private matters that should not be reached in a conversation. I think during the time she worked, it was probably a very valuable skill to know what was okay to talk about and what was not.
ところでお客様は、お仕事は何をなさっているのでしょう?
She changed the topic as if she knew that what I was thinking about. I'm a junker. So I wondered what the hell I was doing. I answered her and smiled bitterly to myself.
と申しますと?
She cocked her head in doubt, as she always had in situations like these, and asked again. Put it in words that you would understand. Call me a garbage collector.
廃品回収業ですか。それは大変尊いお仕事ですね。
She replied with a sweet smile on her face. I was willing to bet that her response would have been the same if she had asked the god of death the same question.
私の業態は、リサイクル性を第一とした設計がなされておりまして。
You're going now, right? Before she could start showing off her abilities, I stood up and threw my backpack around my shoulder.
はい、参りましょう。
And then she started to pick up the bouquet without having learned her lesson. I said to her, leave it right there.
そいつというのは、この…
Yeah, you're just liable to fall the more you carry it around, right?
ですがこれは、お客様のものですので。
Look, I also happen to be the one telling you to throw it away.
ですが…
Fine, that bouquet is mine, so give it to me.
どうぞ、お客様の花束です。
She presented the somewhat lighter bouquet to me with a huge smile on her face. My bouquet, huh? Simply the thing that I was about to throw away and onto the roadway. Right, this just proved that I was unlikely to get used to her aesthetic sense. Finally, I secured the bouquet with one of my backpack straps. Even if I threw such a light thing away at this point, it was not as if my burden would decrease any.
ありがとうございます。
Whether she knew of my internal struggle or not, she suddenly thanked me. Yeah, well, I'm a garbage collector. I answered.
それでは、参りましょう。
She then proceeded to snuggle up next to me as if it were a matter of course. We had been walking for roughly 2 hours. An old shopping district spread out before us. Unlike this district of high-rises that come from, there was a cluster of low buildings, two stores to the most, crowding left and right around the roadways. In the midst, one shop in pitiful shape revealed itself in the midst of the rain. Seeing that this was once a liquor shop, half of an old wooden signpost was engraved with the symbol legend, Liquor Store. The warped and bent iron plates of what had once been dozers, along with chunks of plaster building material, strewn on nearby streets, and glass fragments are scattered about. From destruction, it looked as if the storefront had been torn apart by the blast of a grenade at point-blank range. It was impossible to tell whether this was the intentional handwork of another junker or collateral damage from a battle. The spectacle of that fresh destruction in the midst of this dead ruin for me, which time had otherwise stopped, was as dissonant as a comb that had lost all of its teeth.
お客様、お聞きしてよろしいでしょうか?
She suddenly cut in.
これは車両衝突やガス爆発等の事故でしょうか?
One could say something like that.
でしたら、速やかに救援を呼ばなければなりません。
She once said about testing radio communications that she was so proud of, but it was not as if she could receive a response. Then the second she spoke.
Support center に事故情報を紹介していますが、受講されません。おそらく停電のためと考えられます。私単体では対処できない事態です。とても困りました。
It was already taken care of a long time ago. Look, I'll prove it to you. There's nobody around, is there now? Mishi hung her head. It sounds like I'd seen that particular action out of her.
はい、状況を理解しました。
What? A flashy way to go about breaking things, though. Alright, my grenade launcher again. Wait here.
はい、わかりました。
She saw me off with a very out-of-place smile. I carefully approached the door. As I waved the tefla that greeted me. Fragments of the light and brown and light green colored glass were dispersed all over the narrow interior of the shop. Had I been present at the moment of impact, I probably could have gotten dead drunk off of the stench alone. But time and the rain had now caused everything to sober up. Certainly, if I had searched carefully, I might be able to find a surviving bottle or two. But the current state of affairs would allow me no such luxury. If only the destruction were at least only partial. Full of regret, I returned to the entrance and looked at the place that had once been a liquor shop being beaten down by the rain. Time to go. So when I exited the shop, noticed something green that had hitherto been concealed shining on the side of the footpath. I drew near to it, stepping on the fragmented concrete. But I thought, this was a bottle of what was probably high-grade liquor. The cardboard display had long since run away, but the bottle itself seemed unbroken. The moment I stretched out my hand to grab it, the last moment of a pitiful old man flashed through my mind. A booby trap, huh? While the potential for it being a trap was low, it was still much better to be safe than to be sorry. Shade my surroundings. I couldn't see any wires or trip plates anywhere. The other possibility was the moment a hand stretched out from behind me, beside me and grabbed the liquor bottle. I didn't even have the inclination to get angry with her anymore. And so I merely received the bottle in silence. It was a simple cylindrical bottle, holding what was unmistakably distilled liquor. Immediately broke its seal and opened the plastic cap. This had been the first time that I'd broached the seal of one of my prizes in the location that I had found it in. But I didn't care at this point. As I drew the bottle to my mouth in order to partake of it, an exquisite aroma that time had not decayed one bit filled my nose. This was unmistakably a fine blended whiskey. That's one prize for all my troubles. A smile spread out of me involuntarily. Similarly, my situation is still as bad as it ever was. I still felt good. So some weight had been lifted off my shoulders. She asked just as I was about to taste the liquor. Why do you ask that?
以前にお客様は自分で汲んだ水以外は飲むなと医者に言われている。どうし。
You have a good memory.
ありがとうございます。私はロボットですから。覚えておくのは得意なんです。
Remember one more thing. This is my medicine. As I passed the bottle before her eyes, she very consciously read the label.
いえ、それは薬品類ではなく、スコッチウイスキーだと思われます。カティーサーク12年シェリーバレル、税込み価格。
You are well informed. How wonderful.
はい、ありがとうございます。
I took the opportunity that the shadow box's words of gratitude for them took a swig of the bottle's contents. Quickly choked. The scotch, the first I had imbibed in months, was so strong that my body vomited back up. I took another sip, this time in order to savor the flavor. The air that rushed into me from the bottle was saturated with alcohol, and I could feel the warmth of the liquor in my stomach. Not bad.
Hi, totemo joushitsu de, kinu no you ni nameraka na nodogoshi desu.
Have you ever tried some?
Ie, watashi wa roboto nano de.
That's too bad. Already doing my teetotaler, whatever, robot command honor, I took another swig. Now, if I could only have some cigarettes, this would be a heaven itself. This world would be heaven itself. To be gazed at the destroyed shop, a smile floating to her face. Her shoulders, entirely covered by the waterproof cloak, looked somewhat unsteady to me. The rubble washed by the unbroken sheets of rain glimmered a dull silver color. I sealed the whiskey bottle to its original airtight state and then secured it into a pocket of my backpack. We took a course northwest from there. Because I had chosen to walk through the alleyways, it was difficult to tell where we were. However, I could tell that we were making progress toward the quarantine wall. The air was rife with the scent of rainwater. I could sense no ill will from the continuous falling of the rain. This sarcophagus city, having lost its protective dome, was like an open-faced water tank. Perhaps the entirety of the east side of the city was thus slightly submerged in water. That were the case, then the likelihood of having to fight off a patrol of heavy combat units in this area was low. It appeared that, unless there were patrols that hugged the quarantine wall, we had evaded the warmongers for now. Perhaps because it had grown much colder since the time that we left, she appeared to be in good condition as well.
Planetarium, how is it?
She walked slightly ahead of me, repeating her usual phrase to herself. The sound was now hers. Although the roads were immersed in water, she did not seem to mind at all. With a gait that verged on a dance, she walked along the sidewalks that were devoid of people. The traffic lights, bereft of light, and the road signs, bereft of faces, were simply and quietly bidding her farewell. Both the hush of buildings and this robot shaped like a young woman had, both the hush of the buildings and this robot shaped woman had no duty any longer, and the hundreds of millions of raindrops. It was a scene that made the depths of my heart ache, much like a vague reverie that would vanish by dawn. She came to stop at a rift in the sidewalk and turned in a circle, surveying her surroundings. She then fell into a puddle of water with a grand splash. This was already the 14th time. Well, if memory served, that was. I told you not to look around, did I not? All these falls don't seem to have damaged you. I did not know whether this was the truth or a joke, but she beamed radiantly all the same. While I dripped briskly from the cloak that I had lent her. She probably really did like the rain after all. Perhaps it was due to the alcohol that I had just imbibed, but I found myself thinking that way. Before long, her gait slackened. Do you need a break? Okay. Yeah. Same casual exchange of words that I knew not how many times we repeated. The bouquet hanging from my back, I clinked like some kind of protective talisman along with my footsteps. She spoke those words like a stale joke every single time we came across barricades and barbed wire entanglements. Probably something like that. Yeah, it's just the two of us.
とても退屈なものですが家の中で過ごすのも楽しいものだと思います。ただ、それではプラネタリウムにいらっしゃるお客様が減ってしまうので、私は困ってしまいますが。
She talks as we continue to wander about. Hey!
はい、何でしょう?
Don't you get bored?
退屈と申しますと?
You've worked at the Planetarian for the entirety of your operational lifespan, correct? Have you not ever thought about trying a completely different line of work? This is an abrupt question even coming from me. Why would she, someone who adhered so strictly to her professional duties, decide to abandon her post today and follow me instead? It may have been that the answers to those two questions were not so dissimilar. I thought you would say as much.
ですが、私は今の仕事がとても気に入っています。館長さんやスタッフの皆さんやイエナさんと一緒に働くことはとても楽しくやりがいがあります。今はお客様が少なくなってしまいましたが、でもいつかまた大勢の方々が詰めかけてくれるようになると信じています。
I see. I responded curtly as I looked out at the foggy rain in my path. If I just walked into the mist, to its mist, I would be able to return. Back to the world that I had lived in since the day I was born, back to the world in which I had no choice but to live. However, that was not her world. The only things that would await her when she returned to her beloved workplace were a projector that would never function in the eternity of time. Take this reality, broken and crafted by the unending ruin, and to change it into the meager dreams of which she spoke, was there not any way to make it happen?
お客様、お聞きしてよろしいですか?
She finally opened her mouth again. What is it?
お客様は神様にお願いをしたことはありますか?
No. I think I've answered that question before.
お客様は、あったかもしれないが、ろくな…
You have a good memory?
はい、私はロボットですから、覚えておくのは得意なんです。
I have not yet heard from you what it is that you pray for.
はい、その通りです。
And what do you pray for? I asked. She stood in the midst of the furious rain. She looked back at me, then spoke slowly. She stared at me like a child desperately looking for confirmation. Is that so? She smiled bashfully. For her, these words were probably just an extension of her idle talk. But I was starting to think of other things altogether. When we departed from the Planetarian, she had said that if I continue in the current fate, in the current pattern of usage, then the battery will last for 4 more days. She had probably not thought that the wait would be so long and harsh. No, it was doubtful that she thought that even now. In other words, her batteries would be running out quite soon. If her battery were to cut out by the time we reached the Land Rover, then I'd be able to bring her out of the city without having to worry about how she felt about it. She called out to me, sounding worried. No, I'm fine. No, we're almost there. She again smiled sweetly. I gazed uneasily into the rain, feeling as if she had seen all the way through me. I thought about taking another swig from the whiskey bottle, but I eventually decided against it. I had already been drunk well past my limit even before I'd encountered that bottle of whiskey. The face of that old junker partner of mine suddenly came to mind. I had not heeded that advice, and it may well have been that the time for me to pay the price for that this thing was nigh. What was I to do with her? What exactly was I planning on doing with her? Unable to find an answer to these questions, I simply walked into the midst of the rain. Stop. The precise sound of her footsteps vanished that instant. Wait here. I'll return in 3 minutes. I need to go to the bathroom. She smiled back warmly at me as if my excuse were perfectly logical. Be quiet now. I reminded her once again as I checked the safety of my grenade launcher. Maintaining as low a profile as I could, I made my way under the shadow of rubble. Just as I thought, this alley connected back up to the main street that stretched past the front of the train station I had seen on my way in. The totally abandoned road continued straight for about 300 meters and then abruptly ended in a barricade. After that, the town itself abruptly ended. This was the buffer zone. At the time of the entrenchment of the city as a fortress, the slums that had originally been here had all been demolished to give the machine tool space to work. This also served to make the detection of intruders easy. To that end, the few buildings that were left standing were populated as watchtowers. The flat earth, as boggy as a swamp, was expressionlessly reflecting the lead-colored sky. A wind was blowing through its mist, and beyond that, there arose an enormously reinforced concrete wall out of the mist. The only way out was through the rift in the quarantine wall caused by the kamikaze strike of an autonomous assault mech. It was through here that I had entered the town. The alcohol I'd imbibed suddenly made its presence felt. As I shifted positions, I felt a stabbing sharpness rising in my stomach. I took my binoculars out of my backpack and twirled the focus ring. There was something that was being pounded on by the rain. An old combat mech. A four-legged walker. It stood before the rift in the quarantine wall, its spikes driven into the sledge. The slightly elevated gun turret and the sensor radome mounted to its side. And the barrel of the railgun, so large that it bordered on misshapen, that projected from the other end. Not an energy module or an attendant loader mech in sight. In other words, it was in solo operations mode. Its turn signals and its brake lights, totally unbecoming of an autonomous weapon program, were evidence that it had been manufactured during a time when human law still existed. Its two machine guns, purposed for proximity defense, were swiveling in anticipatory sweeps. A Fiddler Crab. An MK-43LE autonomous fire support mech. That was its official designation. During the war, just about everyone called it a Fiddler Crab. Its external frame constructed for heavy towing, its reinforced rear legs, and its unique barrel jacket mechanism were the specific characteristics that gave it the L and E designations. Unlike the message takers and on the way, this mech was not a rampant warmonger fan faction online at one point of the myriad autonomous airborne factories that once filled the skies. No, this is part of the vanguard of DFARS, the autonomous defense line first deployed when the city was first quarantined. It had the ability to fire just about any kind of bullet with simulated coding into the hard distance at hypersonic speed. There is no way for infantry to fight against such a powerful, heavy, mechanized unit. But as it did have manual override controls, if one could capture it, then one could turn it into one's own personal hunter-killer tank. Worth thinking out, a certain death awaited anyone foolish enough to try. If means had ever been developed to neutralize the man-made bacteria, these cities would then become valuable strategic points over which large-scale battles would be fought. This fellow was probably left here as a trump card just in case such an eventuality should occur. It continued to go about its duties now, regardless of the fact that while it had harbored the entire world had changed and the things that it had been tasked to protect had long since been eaten away by time and the rain. A certain kind of awe rose within me at the sight.
お聞きしてよろしいでしょうか。
What?
あちらに見えるものは何でしょう。
An autonomous fire support mech. Why is it here of all places? Wait, why are you here? I told you to wait where you were.
はい、3分経過しましたが、お客様がお戻りにならなかったので。
I get it. So be quiet.
はい、わかりました。
She not being.
もう一度お聞きしてよろしいですか。
You may ask, but whether I can answer or not is an entirely different matter.
この先のガイドは私のデータベースと大幅に異なるようです。
It's just as you see it.
では、あちらに見えるものは建設機械の類でしょうか。
It's a fiddler crab.
と申しますと。
It's something similar to you.
と申しますと。
Look, just shut up for a second. I surveyed the scene with my doctors once again. Where did it come from? When I had entered the city, there had been no indication that there was any autonomous defense patrol activity in the area. It was as if it had come out to set a trap for me while I was in the planetarium. But if that were the case, then there would not be just one mech lying in wait. It was also possible that it had entered solo operations mode after the power to its nest had been cut off. If I could not silence it with my first shot, then it was very likely that it would call for support from its comrades in the vicinity. If I chose to fight, then I did have a chance of victory at all. Fiddler crabs were designed as defensive fire support platforms that had been built largely without taking close proximity combat into consideration. I knew a few weak points, but there was only one that could be pierced by a 40mm grenade. But I have no choice but to aim at the ammunition bay hatch located at the top of the barrel apparatus. There's probably about a 50% chance more like a 30% chance that I would actually hit. Given that, could I take a detour? Would I be able to cross past the quarantine wall at any other point than that rift? No. If I just walked around blindly, then the danger of running into an enemy patrol would just increase. But it would be suicide to pass that night here as well.
お客様?
I'm going out to hunt.
Kari, と申しますと。
And sure enough, she cocked her head to signify that she understood neither the situation nor the words I had spoken. Put her binoculars. She continued to look on with a very curious air. That was just as well, for I myself did not have the confidence to tell what was going to happen after this. Remain here until I come back. If you don't, it may cost me my life.
申し訳ありません。私には状況がよく理解できませんが、お客様のお命に関わることでしたら、遵守するべきと考えます。
You said very primly clasping your hands before her? I see, so this was the way that I should have ordered her about. All the uneases I had felt just melted away. Finally, there remained one thing that I had to do. I'll be leaving the city soon.
それでは、お車まではもうすぐなのですね。ここまで何事もなくお送りできて、私もほっとしています。
After you part, what do you plan on doing?
はい、私単独で職場に戻りますので、どうぞお気遣いなく。
The city is uninhabited. Even if you were to return to that planetarium, you will never again have any customers. You will never again have a chance to show anyone the stars.And the power supply of the city is at an end. The projector will never operate again. You have seen all of this with your own two eyes.
Hi.
I can see the inner lenses of her since the eyes moving to focus in on me. I kept trying to tell myself that this was just a machine. That her responses to me were nothing more than algorithmic responses to my observed speech and conduct. And then she spoke.
私の基本データベースおよび現在までの蓄積データベースを照合しますと
お客様は必ずお越しになると考えます。停電に関してですが、送電が回復するまで、私もイエナさんもいつまでも待つことができます。
The response from me up until this point was exactly as I had expected. Listen very closely to what I'm about to say and remember it well.
はい、わかりました。
Before you leave this place in one way or another, or the other, make your choice based on the reality that you see here. Neither you nor the Planetarian are necessary for the city any longer. If you wish to continue to work for humans, you have no choice but to come with me. And if you do come with me, I will not be able to know if it will make you happy, nor will I be able to guarantee it. It is your choice whether you stay or not, whether you stay or whether you come with me. It is your choice.
私はこれからも人間の皆様のお役に立ちたいと考えます。それが私の幸せです。
She replied immediately.
ですが、お客様のお話からこれからの行動を決定するには。
You have no means of gaining any more data. You understand this, right? As she understood that the support center no longer functioned, she was made completely autonomous. It is perhaps true that her paradigm of action had become dependent in greatest part on me. For instance, because I had told her that I was sick, she had chosen to escort me regardless of the fact that her battery was about to die. But I had never wanted such a thing. She had shown me the stars. So in turn, I was trying to show her a future that I alone could give her. The fact that she was not human, but a robot did not matter. This was the bond between her and me, and the only proper exchange. Think about it until I come back. Are my grenades her? I slowly stood up.
はい、わかりました。
She said clearly. I'm off.
はい、お帰りをお待ちしています。
Saying this again, but no matter what happens, don't move and don't speak, not until our return. That is, if you believe that my life is important.
はい、お客様が戻ってくるまで、ここから移動せず、声も出しません。重要命令として登録しました。
She smiled sweetly and then closed her mouth. Her figure, which would have looked the same as ever to me, said looked somehow forlorn as it was enwrapped in the rain. Oh yes, keep this for me. I undid the bouquet from the straps on my backpack and passed it over to her. This thing, which had been handcrafted with care, was already breaking down. But if at least its pattern was not salvageable by the time the battle was over, then there wouldn't be no point in my having carried it this far.
はい、大切にお預かりしておきます。
She said, the bouquet in her arms. And that smile, like a little star, graced her face forever. I weaved through the alleyways, coming to the edge of the buffer zone. I found a six-story building whose windows had all been broken, and I walked up to its floors. The place was completely pillaged, perhaps by the hand of another junker. I entered the room at the top floor and took a position at a waterlogged window. The other crab was still standing motionless at the rift in the quarantine wall, as if it were a simple watchdog. From here, I could easily see the gun turret glinting dully in the rain. If it would stay fixed, then it would not be unhittable. At the same time, that meant that I was also within range of those machine guns. The only consolation was that I was in a position well short of minimum allowable range of the railgun. I acted on the barrel of my grenade launcher, and inserted another cartridge. I had chosen a composite armor-piercing directed blast ACDISH grenade set with a 10-meter proximity fuse. This would be able to penetrate the armor of the main cairn, no matter which angle it struck at. But once it fired, I would most definitely be detected. Although I had two more AP cartridges left, I did not think it was likely that I would have a second chance if I did not manage to disable the fiddler crab with my first shot. I closed and cocked the grenade launcher, and then raised the long-distance sight. I calculated the distance to my target, and the ballistic subsidence rate, and corrected my aim accordingly. This grenade launcher was equipped with neither tracer functionality nor a ballistic stabilizer. The sighting power of the cartridges and the construction of the gunstock itself weren't changed from designs of last century. After all, the simpler an armament was, the easier it was to trust it. That was the only rule of social discourse that the unceasing rain had imparted to me. I lowered my head and braced the gun barrel against the window frame and carefully adjusted my aim. The rain was continuing to fall. The wind was intermittently and weakly blowing from left to right across the buffer zone. There was still no indication of movement from my target. The wind kicked up. The muddy water to one side began to ripple like the scales of a fish. I waited for the wind to die down, my fingers still tense on the trigger. I suddenly realized that I was thirsty. Not even the first time when I fought a war wrong so long ago had I felt so nervous. Before I wonder why, I found myself thinking about her. She was probably standing stock still in the middle of that soaked sidewalk right around now, in accordance with my order. Even though I had brought her along with me, I had still not thought of what I was going to do with her. It was just that I could picture what would happen to her if other drinkers happened upon her and harvested her. Charging efforts would be expensive, but not so much that I could never procure it. While it would be difficult to update her software or replace her parts, I could probably at least do some maintenance and minor adjustments for her. For that matter, it might even be possible to procure a small projector for her. Of course, an umbrella-like device with an atmospheric sphere would be necessary for the projection. With those two things, we could travel from settlement to settlement, and with a commentary, we could show the people the starry sky. What if I changed my profession? I might even be able to reach every place where people still live by the time I die. In any case, oh my god, this is just like... In any case, I was sick and tired of being a junker as well. How stupid. I remember as I realigned my aim, which at this point sounded totally askew. That was all just a pipe dream. I must have slipped off into those thoughts because my mind was clouded with fear. They were all just proof that I was starting to think that I couldn't die here. These thoughts didn't feel that bad, though. The wind weakened and finally died down, like the last faint breaths of a dying old man. The feather crab was still aiming its main cannon out rest in the wall, waiting for the arrival of enemy mechs. I've got a friend whose future depends on it, so sorry, but you're going to have to go. I held my breath and squeezed the trigger. The warhead billowed white smoke as it flew and hit the rear of the fiddler crab's railgun. However, nothing happened. I could see the fiddler crab's frame trembling violently, as if in anger. A misfire? I rolled to the side and concealed myself against the wall. I heard one barrel of my grenade launcher and removed the empty cartridge. Having expanded due to the heat, the shell fell into the puddle and there made a hissing sound. I had two cartridges left. Along with the metallic sound of machine guns firing, material from the ceiling began falling around me. The outer walls of the buildings were being raked with machine gun fire. An eternity of time seemed to pass before the first fusillade died down. I sprinted and looked out the window on the other end of the room. Quickly swiveled my head around and took stock of the situation. The Feathercraft's stance had changed. It had locked its legs and connected the wheels on the undersides of those legs to the ground. It was now entering evasive action. When I leaned forward in order to take aim again, it recommenced its machine gun barrel. Hanging my silver green was so riddled with holes that it was as useless as a sponge when shielding me. If I stayed here, this room itself would soon fall prey to the storm of 13mm rounds. I flattened myself and scrambled toward the stairs inside the building. Rain continued to fall. I thudded onto the sidewalk with my head bowed and strained my ears past the sound of rain falling. The high-pitched whine of a low noise emission motor and the sound of sleds being ground under its well-maintained wheels. Sounds that I had heard countless times before, but could by no means ever get used to hearing. My field of vision opened up. There was an abandoned commuter train sitting in the middle of a two-lane railway line. I examined myself and took stock of the situation. The cab was moving rapidly, its four legs tracking through the mud with ease. Just when I thought that it was going to retreat dozens of meters to the side of the quarantine wall, it suddenly altered its course. It suddenly refused to abandon the rift in the wall, which it seemed to consider its post. It seemed that it had not recognized that I was a single infantryman and was instead taking random evasive action against an unknown quantity of enemies. A speed of approximately 25 kilometers per hour, quite slow considering that it was running off of internal power. I could tell that its sensor, mounted on one side, was scanning for my presence. I already knew. The moment that my first shot had failed to explode, I knew that I had lost the gamble. Had I ears that could listen in on a frequency radio communication, I'd probably be hearing the fiddler crab requesting backup from any nearby units right now. Then, in 10 minutes at the soonest, the one human who still breathed in this town would cease to do so. In the midst of this unending rain, the order of this dead town would once again be frozen into place and my fate would be sealed. I was repressing the urge to allow a crazy smile to float to my lips. What I had to do still had not changed. I had to silence the fiddler crab as soon as possible. I then had to retrieve her and slip past the quarantine wall. As I adjusted my grip on my gun, I recalled the words of the captain who commanded my training corps. Never stop moving. Always angle in toward the defensive perimeter and charge forward without fear. Easy to say and difficult to do. 2 AP rounds left. If at all possible, I would have to close in and first knock out a leg. Then I would have to aim for the armored top and destroy it without fail. I took a deep breath and then leapt into the rain. I ran. Having detected me, the feather cup slowed down and entered into a strafing sequence. Proximity sensors had painted me, and the linked turrets were swiveling in my direction. I sprinted forward, kicking up splashes of mud. muzzles of the fiddler cub gun spit out light. I could see 3 points of red light scanning the ground before me in lieu of tracer bullets. A line of thin water spouts kicked up before me, trapping me in a transparent cage. The moment I saw that, I changed my attack vector. After a short delay, the sound of machine gun fire rent asunder the sound of the rain falling overhead. A storm of bullets passed through the area that I had stood in just a second ago. I rectified its aim immediately. I confirmed out of the corner of my eye that the machine gun barrage had stopped for a second. I immediately changed my path even more acutely, planning on doubling back shortly thereafter. It was an old tactic, but an effective one. Because of it, I was able to give it the slip for a second time. At an edge of the buffer zone that struck out like a bridgehead, I came upon the large intact shell of a Puffin Heavy APC. I immediately slid down and used it as cover. I will not have to worry about being hit by even 80 rounds from here. As long as I stay closer than the minimum allowable range, I would be in no danger of being targeted by the Fiddler Cub's main armament, its Lork railgun. I quieted my heavy breathing. The shooting died down. It appeared that my opponent had enough sense to not waste ammunition needlessly. The range between the two of us was a little over 200 meters. Now the hunter would become the hunted. The Fiddler Cub began a rapid retreat. It was an established tactic to retreat and regroup in the case where one did not know the true strength of one's enemy. Manfire resumed once again. A strange sound echoed as the machine gun bullets ricocheted off the armor plating of the APC. It would be difficult to hit a moving target with a relatively slow moving high explosive round from the grenade launcher. I had no choice but to time the motion of my opponent and lead a shot over them. I knew that I was becoming agitated. Blood in my body ran cold and my senses were rapidly sharpening. I suddenly wondered, was she watching? I wanted to tell her that this was what hunting was all about, a ritual of continued bloodshed that mankind had enacted over and over again since the dawn of its history in order to survive. Even though we had once extended our reach into the vastness of space, nothing had really changed. Mankind had now even created for itself game to hunt in it, and had equipped itself with fangs that had not by design been given. The rain continued to fall. Under the giant chase lights around the nearby embankments, the Fiddler Cub continues to face action. I angled my grenade charge obliquely, pictured the position of the Fiddler Cub 5 seconds from now. I used my gun sight to target the area as if I were sticking a pushpin through. One, two, remember as I counted to three. I pressed the trigger. I also drew an arc of white smoke in the air. The Fiddler Cub was in the very place I needed to be in, as if we had choreographed our actions. I had scored a direct hit on the unarmed root hip joint of its right eye and leg. And after several dreadfully tense seconds, a burst of flames bloomed on the Fiddler Cub. As if it were going to fall forward. Its huge form inclined slowly. The ventral ammunition container fell from the Fiddler Cub like a rotten fruit with a crash and an explosion. Having lost one of its joints of a cub frame grown in a multi-layered cord, I may have let out a sound that was neither a cheer nor a scream at that point. The Fiddler Cub was severely wounded, but it wasn't dead. Its composite armor plates were trembling in anger like a proud old knight. The main battery, which had fallen greatly askew, whirred to life and started to track towards me. I watched this occur as if it were happening in a world far removed from mine. The vision disappeared in a swarm of pure white. The familiar sound of metal grinding and salt in my eardrums. The blade blast shockwave scattered raindrops everywhere in a boisterous dance similar to a storm of sea. The wind whipped about me and my nose was filled with the smell of burning ozone. Next moment, my body flipped into the mud as if it had been thrown by a gigantic hand. A mad buzzing filled my ears. I was blinded and couldn't move my legs. They felt as heavy as if they had been cast out of lead. I fumbled around and found that fragments of rubble had toppled over and now blanketed my thighs. Just my body around, somehow I managed to extract myself. Unlike my body, which wouldn't move dexterously at all, my head was swarming with activity. Just now, the Fiddler Cub had aimed in my direction and fired its main cannon. The slug had veered sharply upward and had struck a building instead of me. It was an attack pattern that couldn't have possibly existed, not against a single infantryman at point-blank range. I tried to move out of the immediate vicinity. If it were running off internal power, it would take 25 seconds for the Lark on a Type LE to be fully recharged. If I didn't move now, then with the next shot, the building would collapse on top of me. As I made to retreat, I realized that I had no sensation in my right leg. It seemed like it was broken. Both my eyes and my feet now, huh? As the dull pain began to creep up from my leg, I started to laugh. Even now, the rain still continued to fall. And now, I finally understood the situation. so that thing was broken as well. Embraced in the arm of the unending rain, that agonized monstrosity of the streamer was still dreaming. Dreaming of the gentle city that it was charged to protect, and of the mighty enemies that it was charged to destroy. I hear a sound reminiscent of a thunder clouds crackling, its condensed coils were charging. My part, I could hear the sound of things underfoot and the echoing horizon thereof. My eyes went open as if they had been run through with splinters. The hood of my waterproof cloak had been ripped off, so I could feel the fragments of concrete falling on me directly overhead. No, these were drops of rain. The rain was simply continuing to fall, as if not a single thing had changed. I had absolutely no idea where I was. I was probably several meters from my starting point, but I didn't know anything other than that. One of my feet had got snagged on something and I tumbled to the ground. The grenade launcher rolled up from my hands. The inside of my mouth was cut, and I could taste lukewarm blood spreading out from within. I could hear it charging. I woke up without a shriek. It collapsed on the ground as fragments of concrete and glass pelted my waterproof cloak like many tiny bullets. It hit a building that was very close to me. All I could do was cover my head, my arms, and endure it. A few large fragments hit me directly on my back. I could feel the warmth of blood soaking my undergarments and the crevices of my skin. I too was breaking down in the midst of the rain. There was no pain. The only thing was that it was incredibly difficult to breathe. Any more than this, and I wouldn't be able to take a single step further. Even if my eyes were shut, it was easy to tell where the feather cub was just by sound. The three remaining legs would not be strong enough to absorb the recoil of the work. Every single time it moved, it was destroying its own frame by itself. Every single time it moved, the outcry of warped metal and shredding carbon fiber resonated dissonantly in the air. The sounds were nothing other than its death agony. It's gone mad? Oh, so what the fuck was I saying? Or is it someone else could hear my words? Just what had gone mad? Was it this Baalmech, which had so lost itself in anger that it was bringing everything around it within the city that I was supposed to protect, without regard to a friend or foe? Or was it this Tarkovia city, which had ceased to function so long ago, and in which now only lived the rain and the memories of those who had once inhabited it? Or perhaps... he was laughing. Beyond the rain-soaked wind, the out-of-order Baalmech was laughing shrilly. All around were soaring yet very distinctly audible. I got up and then assumed the firing stance. Even if its legs were broken, there was no way I would be able to get out of sight of it. Right, this time around, it definitely not makes its enemy. That is, unless it had a sliver of reason or mercy left in it. I tried to open my eyes. It was to see for myself the shape of the bed and rewarded it. Filikov had stopped moving. She was standing there in the middle of the buffer zone. At some point, she had flung off the waterproof cloak that I had given her. With a tender smile on her face, she stood before the gigantic battle mech. It was like a scene from an antique religion painting. Without any hesitation at all, she walked towards the feathered crab. It was a calm, sure gait, like that one would display when one walked forth to greet an old friend. The feathered crab appeared bewildered. It had disengaged from firing position and was scanning her with its civilian detection sensors. I forced to slam myself back into reality, trying to overcome my paralysis. I only had one chance to destroy it, and it was now. I found the grenade launcher that I had dropped in a puddle. I fumbled to crack one barrel and finally managed to load it with my last AP cartridge. One strike it with its armor preserved from ground level, I would have noticed it put the fire at a high angle. I did not have time to adjust my sights either. With my axe still plastered to the mud, I eyeballed the distance of the gun turrets and then pointed my grenade launcher at the sky. And then in the span of several seconds, it all happened. The twin machine gun turrets slowly started to revolve as if they had finally decided on something. She simply continued to walk toward the fiddler crab, step by step. I pressed the trigger. The feathered crab machine gun spat out flames. The 40mm canister arced through the threatening sky, trailing white fumes behind it. A line of 13mm machine gun rounds kicked up a path of water toward her like a murderous red serpent. The canister hit. I could see the feathered crab's main cannon seeming to expand. The ammunition bay hatch blew asunder, letting smoke and leaping flames billow forth. The fiery serpent continued to track toward her delicate body as if to eat her alive. And then... her body, torn apart by the bullets, danced in the air like a bird. The rain continued to fall. The feather crab had fallen completely silent. As if it had returned to sanity As Wilson was as Wilson, the long barrel of his ray gun was pointed toward the rift in the quarantine wall. However, that gun would never fire again. The ammunition inside the main armament had all been reduced to explode, and black smoke was rising from the crevices and armor plating. This was a sight that could be seen anywhere in this dead city. It was freezing cold, and my breath frosted white. This widely scattered wreckage was steaming in the rain. I walked forward, pulling my broken leg behind me and following the bullet marks on the ground, and finally arrived where she lay. Her shaking lips opened and clearly called out to me. You can speak?
Hi. 緊急作動用電池に切り替えました. お客様? お怪我はございませんか?
Told you not to move until I returned. Why'd you do such a stupid thing? As usual, she smiled. Fingertips dirtied by the mud were gently trembling. Underneath fractures in her skin, a dark metallic frame was forlornly exposed.
暴走状態にあると思われる未登録機体に強制停止信号を発信しましたが、受講されませんでした。信号出力が弱い、もしくは受信側に問題が発生していると判断し、物理操作での緊急停止を試みましたが、失敗しました。These
were her words, and yet these were not. And yet these were not her words.
暴走状態にある機体は現在機能を停止していると。
This was an incantation totally unrelated to the will that had been sealed within the depths of her main memory.
該当する機体から速やかに離れ、最寄りの警察機関、もしくはサポートセンターにご連絡ください。
As she said all this, she looked over at me once again and blinked as if she was relieved.
通用命令を破ってしまい、申し訳ありませんでした。もっと古い約束事があるものですから、人間に危害を加えたり、
Right。人間に危害が及ぶのを看過してはならない。私たちはロボットです。ですからこれは忘れることのできない。これを守ることが私たちロボットの誇りです。She said that it was her honor. That the instinct that the human beings who had never cared about anything other than themselves had embedded into her was an honor.
お客様? お怪我はございませんか? お怪我はございませんか?
Oh, I'm fine. That was all I could manage.
本当に良かったです。
And again, she smiled.
お預かりした雨具と花束はあちらの歩道に置いてあります。この道を少しお戻りになればすぐに見つかると思います。
She turned her neck as if to show me the way. Her eyes caught the wreckage of the battle mech.
に代わって心よりお詫び申し上げます。きっと彼も壊れていたんだと思います。私たちロボットは人間の皆様の幸せのためにありますから、あのような乱暴なことは本当はしたくなかったんだと思います。私にはわかります。
Put my arm around her back, just so I could hold her close. She shivered several times as if she was having convulsions. Everything below her chest had been torn asunder by machine gun fire. There was no way to put her back together now. So many precise parts were dispersed throughout the rain, similar to entrails made of metal. It seemed that if I tried to move her even just a little bit, she might never move again. I want to scream. I was just as broken as she was. There's still a squad of warriors defending these ruins. And now that I had destroyed its vanguard, the remaining warriors would be forming around toward this location. If I was going to escape, the time was now. But despite this, here I was, unable to leave this place.
およそ600秒で緊急作動用電池が残量ゼロになります。バックアップ用電池が消耗しているので、その後は起動不能となります。 メンテナンス コールを発信していますが、受講されません。サポートセンターは 現在通信不能です。緊急用サテライトコールを発信していますが、中継衛星が見つかりません。少しだけ心細いです。
She's as if in jest, continuing to smile the same as ever. She was listening to empty space with her antenna that were no longer of any use. She was calling for aid that would never come, no matter what. I found that I was unable to bear watching her do this. You don't have to call anyone. I'll save you. I'll repair you, so... Blue and white sparks flew as the rain hit the exposed machinery of her chest, now bereft of insulation and her lead sheet. As if she were following my gaze, she said with embarrassment, Her tone and her facial expression seemed to me to be in the deepest agony. I already knew. With the engineers who would be able to repair her, as well as the new exposure that she wanted, even those people who needed her. They were all things that had disappeared from this world so long ago. She smiled and looked up at the rain for some time. And then she turned to face me again. Sound of her turbo motors echoed like bitter wheezing. She bent herself back quietly and then proudly showed me a nameplate glinting in the rain.
ですが、皆さん喜んでくれます。また来るね、ゆめみちゃんと。私に言ってくれます。私はみんな覚えています。私はロボットですから覚えておくのは得意なんです。少しだけお見せしますね。
Lenses installed in both her eyes began emitting a faint light. This was the holographic videotape playback mechanism that she was so proud of. A circle screen like a crystal globe coalesced around the breast of her crumbling uniform. The focal axis of the lenses must have been skewed by the gunfire because I could see the projected images wavering.
星野夢美です。とても素敵な名前をありがとうございます。
Her voice slowed from the set of speakers. Close to her ears. I did double take and focus as intently as I could on the image being displayed. There were a lot of people. The production room was packed with people, and every chair in the room was filled. This scene was one that she recorded with her own eyes.
一生懸命頑張りますので、どうぞよろしくお願いします。
The entire production room shook with the sound of applause. Next, a very young girl. A long skirt came up close. In her arm, she was holding a bouquet that was about as large as she was.
Yumemi-chan! Hai, dozo!
The girl stood up on her tiptoes and then presented the bouquet.
Arigatou gozaimasu!
And another thunderously hearty round of applause.
Watashi no shūgin-shiki desu. Zenbu de 1263人 no katagata ga watashi no namae o kangaete kudasattan desu. その中から館長さんとスタッフの皆さんが一つだ。それが星野夢美です。私はとても気に入っています。他の1262人の方々がつけてくださった名前もとても気に入っています。
Circle screens get faded and the figure of the young girl vanished.Strictly strained my eyes, I could see an even frailer scene starting to play. Two were sitting in front of her, as if they were getting a souvenir photograph taken.
Yumemi-chan, 綺麗な星をありがとう。今度は友達みんなで来るから、それまで元気でね。
Next, a well-built male customer.
次は結婚記念日に妻を連れてきます。
was all he said as he gently rubbed her head. Then an entire sequence of people appeared and vanished.
子供の頃のような素晴らしい星空でした。来年の今日にもき
っと星のことがいろいろ分かって面白かったです。夏休みの自由研究には夢美ちゃんのことを書こうと思います。
めちゃめちゃ綺麗で、すっごく感動しました。絶対また来ます。
子供が途中で泣いちゃってごめんなさいね。ほら、ロボットのお姉さんにごめんなさいわ。
夢美ちゃん大好き。
Every single person had words of thanks and a kind smile for her. Every single person promised from the bottom of his or her heart that they would definitely come again.
ありがとうございます。またのお越しを心よりお待ちしています。
No matter how old or of which sex the customer was, she invariably responded thus and bowed deeply. That is why this particular projection ended with a close-up view of the floor. These were all of her precious, precious memories. They're all maddening visions of a time when the world was still moving in the right direction, when people were still reaching out towards the stars.Again, the image wavered and then shifted into a completely different one. The background was the reception area of the planetarium. It seemed like she was bending over a little. She was engaged in two small silhouettes at their level. The silhouette seemingly like a young girl was looking intently into the camera.
お尋ねの星の正式な名前か座標はお分かりになりますか？
Girl was silent at that.
お父さんとお母さんの星はまだ新しいから、ゆめみちゃんも知らないんだよ。
The other and slightly larger silhouette answered from the other side. This would have to have been a little girl and her big brother.
ゆめみちゃん、そうだよね。
はい。超新星や彗星などが出現した場合は、私のデータベースにはすぐには反映されない場合があります。誠に申し訳ありません。
She again bowed politely.
あのね、お父さんとお母さんはマレネタリクスで働いてるんだよ。
マレネクタリスだよ、ネタリクスじゃなくて。
そうですか、とても立派なお仕事ですね。
この前の事故で二人とも死んじゃったんだけど。
The big brother fell silent with that.I wanted to reach out my hands to them, but my body wouldn't move. The feeling was maddening, for I knew full well these were images captured during a summer 30 years ago. With that hologram, that big brother and little sister were still unaware of the true nature of the tragedy that had befallen them. The military invasion of the moon's second part at Marinus was first announced to the Republic as a problem with the power reactor. Thousands of people had vanished just like that, and the government concealed the truth from the iron grasp over the media. Even that was nothing more than a prologue for what was to come. Not 1 month after that,War began to ravage the entire earth.
あのね、お父さんとお母さんはお星様になったんだよ。だからお兄ちゃんとここに見に来たの。
そうなんですか。今日はご満足いただけましたか？
うん、とっても綺麗だった。
いつでも見に来てくださいね。イエナさんはとても素晴らしい性能ですから。いつでも父さんとお母さんの星につきましてもきちんと調べておきますので。
うん、この次はおじさんに行ってちゃんとお金もらってくる。
ゆめみちゃん、またね。
はい、ありがとうございます。またのお越しを心よりお待ちしています。
Clicking sound came from her right ear.The brother and sister rippled like water and vanished, and a different image came into focus. It was the projection room. I could see a silhouette of a projector slanting diagonally in the midst of a dim background. There were five, maybe six adults standing around her. Everyone was holding something in his or her hand. It's obvious that those were the rough gas masks that were in general use during pre-war days.
館長さん、ただいまイエナさんに異常があるようです。
Her voice said,
南天および北天の恒星電球が取り付けられていません。 次回の投影まであと22分ですので、早急な対処が必要と考えます。
大丈夫だよ、夢見。何も心配することはない。
Suvetta was standing directly in front of her. Perhaps a middle-aged man replied thus. But it was in a voice that made it seem as if he was trying to tell himself the same thing.
Yumemi-chan?
The voice said. A woman's voice, it seemed.
私たちね、しばらくみんなで旅行に行くことになったの。
はい、ご旅行ですか。それは素晴らしいですね。
それでね、Yumemi-chan には留守番をお願いしたいの。私たちが帰ってくるまでここで待っていてほしいの。
Even from the small tiny speaker of the olive player, you could tell that the young woman's voice was shaking.
わかりました。皆さんがお戻りになるのはいつでしょう。
She asked her response, not having changed at all from its usual routine. But her response, another voice answered her.
まだわからないの。
The image became very slightly slanted. Ah, she was cocking her head in doubt as she would usually do in such circumstances.
Minasan's 休暇は無期限ということですか？
そうね。長くなるかもしれないし、すぐに帰ってくるかもしれない。
ご旅行先はどちらでしょう？きっととても楽しいところなのですね。
Probably had that same warm smile on her face as she said this. It represented all of the members of the staff who had fallen silent. The man that she called Mr. Manager now opened his mouth.
近い夢見。私たちは必ず戻ってくる。誰一人欠けることなく、必ずここに戻ってくる。その時はまた一緒に働いてくれ。
はい、館長さん。
She answered clearly.
Yumemi-chan, mata ne.
Mata na, Yumemi.
Kanarazu mata aeru kara. Mattete ne, Yumemi.
Yumemi-chan.
The suspect was unable to summon any words at all. His employee flung her mask to the ground and swept up the robot in an embrace.
Konna no okashii yo.間違ってる、間違ってるよ。だって置いていけないよ。ゆめみちゃんを置いていくなんて、そんなのできるわけないよ。だってゆめみちゃん、私たちの仲間だよ、友達だよ。私たちの中で一番働き者なんだよ。私たちとゆめみちゃん何も違わないよ、ゆめみちゃん。
私はロボットです。
Sorry.
私には休暇は必要ありません。ですが、皆さんには休暇は必要だと考えます。
ゆめみちゃん。
The girl broke down crying at that point, tears streaming down her face.
ごめんね、ゆめみちゃん。こんなところに一人ぼっちで。
Probably where she got the apologies from. Broke into a voice filled with so much lament that it was as if her body entire would burst asunder from the strain. That feeling propagated outwards and swept all the members of the staff into itself. Understandable. This hologram must have been created immediately after the germ bomb bombardment of the major cities of the world.They would now have to flee from the city with just clothing on their backs and nothing else. They were not permitted to bring any equipment at all along with them.
皆さんはなぜお泣きになっているのでしょう。私はまた何か粗相をしましたでしょうか。重大な間違いをしましたでしょうか。だとしたら本当に本当に申し訳ありません。
ゆめみちゃん、違うの。違う。ただね、
That is somewhat common for us, albeit one still filled with tears, answered.
一緒に行けたらいいのにって。ゆめみちゃんと一緒に行けたらきっと楽しいのになって。そんな風にね。
And then in the same fashion as the other festival member, this voice was also grew choked with
cheering.
She answered brightly, as if nothing had changed from usual at all.
どうぞ楽しいご旅行を。
I hear her voice growing softer and more intermittent. She's probably going to finish up saying the things she welcomes everyone with. And was quietly soaking her mud-covered uniform. Yeah, what is it? Her cervical vertebrae made a muddy sound and her neck moved slightly. Her eyes of optic resin reflected the world around her. Darkened sky, the earth soaked in rain. These ruins destroyed in the image of man. Rain gave no indication of stopping, not even now. She gently smiled up at me as I sat there, unable to say a word. Looked directly into my eyes. By now, I understood. Not a single person, not a single result had told the truth. It was a slow robot in the shape of a young woman. It was a slow existence which had been created by man for the service of man and man alone. Very well. Listen closely.
Hi.
Tell you the truth, I came to get you.
と申しますと?
And she inclined her head just a little bit in her usual doubt. Beyond that wall lies your new workplace. I pointed my finger at the looming quarantine wall. At the uninhabited, submerged wasteland that lay beyond the quarantine wall. Your partner projector, as well as your colleagues, are all waiting there. Your customers are packed into a full house waiting for you. Everyone is awaiting your commentary with great anticipation. You'll work in there from this day forth. You'll be able to work at what you want to forevermore. Rain continued to fall. She did not reply at all. As if she were gathering the last of her power, she narrowed her eyes slightly and stared out at where I was pointing. And then she whispered, "It's just like heaven." Is it not? Yes. I nodded. Yes, so it is. As she looked at me attentively and calmly, she again lapsed into silence. Her artificial pupils trembled slightly as if she were gazing at something behind me. Sure, what is it? She said, smiling with absolute innocence. I understand. I'll take you there, I answered. She was silent for a short time, a second of which was an eternity. Her eyeballs started to shake bit by bit, but her eyes remained open. She's probably unable to close her eyes. She tried to turn her neck, but even that no longer worked. She was not even able to focus her eyes any longer. Her eye sockets were overflowing with the downpouring rain and streams of water were flowing incessantly from the corners of her eyes. It was almost as if she really was crying. There it is.
えることのない美しい呼吸のきらめき、満天の星々も皆様もお待ちしています。プラネタリウムはいかがでしょう。どんな時も決して消えることのない美しい呼吸のきらめき、満天の星々が皆様をお待ちしています。プラネタリウムはいかがでしょう。どんな時も決して消える
That's what I have to speak again. It's only akin to a smile float up to her dimmed eyes. And she stopped moving. Looking at the rain that she loved so much. She was staring so happily up at it. As if she would never in all eternity tire of it. Recent cold rain was falling. I gently brushed her wet hair aside with my fingertips and searched around her ears. The slot had been unlocked and the plastic memory card was sticking out, waiting for me to take it. She already released the card at her last moment. I gently pulled the memory card out of its slot, and then I lay her body down in the mud. The memory card was about the size of a cigarette pack and was slightly warm. The warmth evaporated away slowly in the middle of my hands. I retrieved my waterproof cigarette case from inside my cloak, put the memory card inside and sealed it tight. Through the gaps in the rain, I could hear treads and mechanized feet coming in my direction. This was the sound of the hunter-killer warmongers. I looked up at the sky that was storming without end. And then, I dropped my grenade launcher into a bottle. I would not need such a thing, not where I was going. The rain was still falling, even now. Hurt was secure next to mine. I began to walk. Where were the stars now? Where would I have to go in order to see them? Walked forth into this fractured world, yet my thoughts were forever of the sky.
Thank you. think I've ever cried this much since the ending of Persona 5. That was a good VN. I was told that it was sad, but I didn't expect it like this. Yeah, so after the Steins Gate podcasts go up, we'll probably be doing a little discussion on this. It's gonna be like a single podcast when we do it, but like, yeah. I'd like to thank Bread from the Kinnikuy Sensation for recommending this to me. And I'd like to thank anyone who is watching this currently as a VOD. For second round. And yeah, I don't know. Tomorrow I might stream either Steins Gate or Prey. Probably Steins Gate, because I do need to get that done. Thank you guys for watching, and I'll see you all next time.